Hi everybody. As we say in England, now it's something completely different. So what I want to cover today is why I'm standing here, some of the golden years of Amiga from the UK point of view, where Amiga was truly an institution. The question that everybody's been asking today, what the hell happened? And then, life after Commodore. People thought, the press thought, we'd actually bought David Benson and I'd actually managed to buy Amiga. We got very close, and I'll talk a bit about that. And what was actually going on at the Commodore auction. I like to say, I was there the day the bomb went up, because the Commodore auction was the day the Oklahoma City bombing happened. And I remember sitting in New York watching the TV screen in horror. But that was a day to remember in many ways, not just for the community. So, who am I? I'm a Newcastle United supporter, trapped in a Chelsea shirt. Things we do for our jobs. I'm a non-technical guy in a technical world, surrounded by great engineers, great people, and an amazing Amiga family. Andy Warhol tells us we get our 15 minutes of fame, and in the early 90s I had my 15 minutes of fame with Amiga. I count myself very fortunate. And one of the proudest accomplishments of my career is the year we spent keeping the Amiga brand alive between the Commodore liquidation in April 92 and ESCOM's purchase of the assets in April 95. Commodore in the 80s and to an extent up to the 90s was a computer. For those who don't know, Commodore actually was the number two by volume computer company in Europe. It was a major business company, as well as the C64, which was a recreational slash business machine. Commodore was very big, 286, 386, but never made it to 486. Amiga became the predominant games machine in Europe. So, 92, Commodore was a computer company. By 93, we rebranded completely to focus on Amiga, because Amiga was the future, clearly. In the UK, selling the hardware is about the application, it's about the bundles, it's about the attraction. So every Christmas we had a new pack, and mid-year we usually had a different pack. The secret to success was picking the right software to go in the pack. So those days, the games were selling in the UK at around $40 a game. So we could buy it at 50 cents a unit and put 5 or 6 games in the pack. So you were actually got a free machine with the software you were buying in a Commodore pack. Okay, 60% of our sales were through retail, and 70% of those were through the major retail chain. Most of the sales were Christmas sales. So the big stores make their purchasing decision in August about where your product is going to be, how much shelf space you're going to get, and how much you're going to order. So by August, you have to have the machines ready, the games ready, pack ready, it has to look really good, and if it looks good enough, they'll stock it. And if they stock it, they sell it. So it's all about positioning and stocking, getting those decisions right. We get 1,200 bundles. We try to make the bundles all inclusive, so there's everything you need to get going as a bigger computer user. How strong was the Amiga brand? In 1993 of UK specialist games retailers. We were really close to Sega. 83% of retailers stopped at Amiga. It was a major brand. This is a CU Amiga magazine. CU Amiga was one of a number of titles, about six or eight, and sold over 400,000 units monthly. That's a $35 million a year business on Amiga magazine. This magazine celebrated the launch of the CD32 console. Remember, back in those days, there were no DVDs, there was no MPEG-1 format, that was coming, but not released yet. There was concern about what the machine was, how it worked, what it would do. So positioning it was key, but this was the predominant machine in the market. It was the first 32-bit computer to get to market, and fantastic. With the package that we got out for Christmas that year, we were set to go. CD32, along with the 1200, which was very strong, would be the machine to save Commodore. If only we got enough supply at the time. We believed that we could sell in Europe 400,000 machines that year, and that was the target, the focus for our campaign. The main competition was Sega, who had a 16-bit machine. I don't know whether you've seen this campaign. What Sega does is say, be this good takes ages. They then flip the ages round to say, to be this good takes Sega. Smart advertising. So we went one further. Then, in December 93, at the end of November 93, we got a call from the advertising agency saying, we've had a billboard come up on the west, which is the main route into London from Heathrow Airport. Millions of commuters use that every day. We can put your advert on the billboard. We said, that sounds great. We didn't think that it was outside the state of the Well, we didn't think twice about it once we said, yes, of course. So what happened to Commodore? It wasn't the technology. The technology was and is fantastic. The team that developed it, are rightly proud of the accomplishment. It was the people around them that screwed it up. Lack of focus. We had Commodore with a 64, which is a business computer. Amiga is a gaming computer. The CDTV is a home entertainment system. And the CD32 is a games console. Most of these product lines require different distribution channels. So, in order to succeed in these markets, each one requires a separate focus. Each one requires a pretty separate channel, separate sales force, separate marketing. Commodore's structure was such that each unit operating entity was left to operate individually. So everybody was making different decisions, having different focus on which way to go. CDTV. I think it's a beautiful machine, but the problem we had was telling the public what it was and why they should have one, and why they should move the games machines out of the bedroom into the living room. The other issue we had was CDTV, and the disc format was all the media owners, movie companies, the other people that have the video content were definitely scared of piracy. you bring that machine out, it doesn't have a recording device today, but you're going to get all the digital rights that put a recording device in, and piracy will be rampant. So there's a lot of industry reluctance to adopt it, as well as mass confusion on what it was, which is why the CD32 was quickly replaced by the CDTV. CD32. But to be successful, it's not just the hardware package, it's about the killer app. What do you do with it? We never found a killer app for the CDTV that made people say, I must have one of these. And that is one of the areas where Commodore bottled. Keeping the software community, the developer community, behind the product, behind the machine, is vital. With the CD32, it was all about the titles that we could put on the machine. Lack of leadership. What do I mean by that? Mehdi Ali was a leader who believed in his style of leadership. He didn't delegate. He made sure he retained power. There were no functional heads. There was no business coordination. When we got together for meetings in each country, operating unit would be kept separate from all the others. A deliberate part of his strategy to make sure nobody else had power in Commodore. So there was no cross-fertilization, or very limited cross-fertilization of ideas and processes. In fact, the operating units were encouraged to compete with each other. The Germans are always told how good the British were, the British are always told how good the Germans were. And just created an atmosphere where he thought he was stimulating business and making us all try harder, but really didn't benefit the company. My personal example of Eddie's management style is the first role in Commodore was in Germany, where I was asked to go sort out their inventory problems. I start looking into that and find out there are a range of issues with inventory because they basically kept everything they ever made and everything they thought they were going to make in a warehouse somewhere. So there was 10 years of inventory. I put my report together and told the German management group what I was going to tell Mehdi. They told him, you can't say that. But that's true. You can't say that, you'll fire us. I'm sorry, that's true. So, the day comes with Mehdi has the meeting. There are 8 German managers sitting in the room. And tell Mehdi that on your balance sheet you have $46 million of inventory. I think it's actually worth $8 million. You have a $38 million write-off. And oh, by the way, for the last 5 years, we've been hiring 5 extra warehouses to store the inventory that's not worth it. The next day, 4 of those managers came in. Lack of execution. The A600, as most of you know, was really the A300. It was meant to be a low-cost follow-on to the A500, which was very successful. Unfortunately, the A300 cost more than the 500, so it had to be priced above the 500, which made it the 600. And we had to go out and convince people why they should pay more for a 600 that has less features and less functionality than the 500 that they knew was like. So that was launched April 92. It didn't succeed. So the A1200 was launched in October 92 to make up for the 600. The issue there is, as I've explained, in the UK and in most of Europe, the market is a Christmas market, and the retailers make their purchase decisions in September. So if they weren't stocking the 1200, they already made their commitment. So they didn't get the 1200 on the shelves. We didn't sell any 600s, because everybody gets an Amiga magazine that read what the 1200 was, way better machine than the 600. CD32 was launched that we'd have 100 titles by Christmas. And that those titles would be brand new titles reflecting the ability of the CD32 to perform. We never got anywhere near 100 titles, and we got very few dedicated custom CD32 titles there. We lost the trust of the developers in the software industry. They just weren't behind the plow the way they'd been the previous year. The CD32 was not a success. In the PC market, I think Commodore could have done better than it did. It was very successful in the days of 286 and 386, but they were convinced that PC sold not functionality. So we chased the PC market down to the bottom, trying to be the lowest cost supplier of the PC, rather than finding a niche, sticking with that, which I believe the Commodore brand would have enabled us to do. So, a lot of Commodore machines and Amigas were made in Hong Kong. And in 1990, somebody made the brilliant decision that Hong Kong was going to be ceded to the Chinese in 1997. That was a politically unstable environment, and it was best to diversify away from that. So in 1991, they announced they were relocating manufacturing to the Philippines. Everybody, almost everybody with supervisory or management level, left Hong Kong manufacturing to find a company that would be around in 97 so they could relocate out of Hong Kong. So they decided to manufacture in the Philippines. Who remembers what happened in the Philippines in 1991? The Commodore plant was in the ash fallout zone. So that delayed manufacturing by 6 months to the middle of 1992. So we're trying to fly machines into the UK. The manufacturing is already late. And in September 1992, we discovered that there is not sufficient air freight capacity out of Manila Airport into Europe to ship the machines we needed to get to our retailers in time for them to stock it for Christmas. Nobody had checked and mind in detail like that. So, misfortune, mismanagement, misuse of great technology and a very strong brand. So that was 1993 when we changed the focus from Commodore to Amiga. '93-'94 was also a period of change. PCs were starting to go into the games market. There you can see in 1994 250,000 PCs were sold into homes, small office, home office use. That kept doubling year by year by year. So we know that number in 1994 was less than the number of Amigas we sold in 1993. The change was coming. Another Amiga magazine. One tells the world that the UK management team has succeeded in buying the assets of Commodore. Not quite true. David Pleasance and I, subsequent to the liquidation in 1994, kept the UK trading as a good going concern and pull together a consortium of investors to buy the assets of the Amiga at Commodore. We believe, correctly as it turned out, that it would take about $15 million to buy the assets, and we needed another $35 million working capital. If we got enough working capital to get machines out on the streets, we then intended to float the business on the Canadian Stock Exchange, because the lead investment firm we were dealing with was Canadian. We actually raised $25 million from a consortium of investors, and we raised another $25 million from a Chinese company called Newstar, who we had signed to manufacture the Amigas in China. What happened 3 days before the auction, Newstar informed us they had pulled out of our bid. They'd been talking to ESCOM. It came the day of the auction, they came in and sat down with the ESCOM team. ESCOM had promised them that they would give them the manufacturing rights for Amiga without having to put up the $25 million, and that they would do great business together. They never made an Amiga. What we said at the auction, this is David Pleasance and myself, telling the world that we'd be happy to work with ESCOM in whatever way that the UK was a great asset to Amiga and to Commodore, and we'd be happy to work together. At the auction in New York City, Dell was there, who wanted a bid, but their bid was not unconditional. They wanted an extra month to do due diligence, and the liquidators wanted to sell immediately. Samsung was there. They wanted to be under the counter, and nobody would know that they were there, so they took everybody on a private basis. Gateway didn't buy the assets then, they bought them later when the price came down. There was an Amiga guy from Miami who wanted to buy it, and we were there hoping something would change, but unfortunately it didn't. But we were talking to everybody else who would buy it, talking to them about the UK, saying in the UK, we will work with you, we'll help you build the brand, whatever you want to do. So we actually liquidated the UK business in August 1995. After we talked to ESCOM, I went to see Manfred Schmidt in Germany, and he said, well, I might be interested in the UK assets, but I want you and David to run the company. I said, well, my heart's really moved on from Amiga now. I have different plans. Thank you very much for the offer, but you have a great team of folks in the UK. I'm sure they'll work very well. He folded his arms, leaned over the table, looked at me and said, how could you possibly go back to England and sleep at night knowing you put 30 people out of work with your decision? You have to work for me. So I said, thank you. I don't work for blackmailers. Now, final little known fact about the UK. This is Operation Desert Storm, 1991. In 1990, what's this got to do with Commodore? In 1990, when Iraq invaded Kuwait, one of the side effects was there was a Kuwaiti Amiga distributor who had just taken a brand new shipment of 1084Ss, a beautiful monitor. So he had 200 1084Ss in his warehouse. The Iraqi soldiers came in, thought they were TVs, couldn't get them to work, so they smashed them. The Kuwaiti distributor said that was an act of war, a result of the US invasion of Iraq, therefore it's plausible. course I'm not paying you for the monitors. So in 1995, we still had on our books a debt from the Kuwaiti distributor for $80,000 for 1084S monitors, which the liquidator actually collected on. Has anybody got any questions? Yes.
Why do you think the Amiga was so popular in the UK compared with other regions?
I think the Amiga was popular in the UK for two reasons. One, we had a very strong relationship with all the popular games developers, so we could get the top games in the bundle. And two, we worked very hard on distribution. We had two major distributors, SDL and ZCL, who handled all the independents. And the major retailers who we looked at very well, paid a lot of attention to, and we made sure that their needs were catered for.
That's a wonderful lesson in how only a terrible thing is. What if you take away the top two categories?
What I've taken away is balance is important. Don't ask people to do anything that you wouldn't do or you're not prepared to do. Fear is not a motivator. Recognize people's success, recognize hard work, and treat everybody with the respect which you would like to be treated with. Yeah?
What other European countries were the Amiga released?
The main Amiga countries were Holland, Germany and the UK, but we were actually in most European companies through distribution where we didn't have a direct subsidiary.
It was pretty popular from there.
In India?
Italy.
Italy, yes. But that was through a distributor, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
I saw the box you had.
Yes. There weren't any of the uniquely designed for CT32 titles. There were very few available and we had to put it forward there. We had to get a bottle out. Okay. Oh, yeah.
There were rumors that Commodore was involved in
Commodore UK was not. Commodore was a complex organization. For example, Commodore UK bought its equipment from Commodore Switzerland, which bought it from Commodore Hong Kong, which bought it from Commodore Philippines. I spent many hours negotiating with the Inland Revenue on transfer pricing practices, which they believed were illegal, because how can a company like Commodore lose so much money when it's so popular? And it's hard to argue that, well, that's due to incompetence, not transfer pricing. Anything else? No? Thank you.